Hi, and welcome to this lecture on GWASP by subtraction, which is a specific model you can use in genomic SEM to separate out the signal that is shared between two traits from the signal that is specific to one of the two traits. We get a lot of questions about this model based on our paper, where we use this model to split the signal in educational attainment into a part of the signal that's attributable to cognitive abilities and a part that's attributable to other traits, so non-cognitive abilities. And we'll go through this model step by step. And as this is sort of a practical workshop, we're going to do it by looking at the model and looking at the genomic SEM code in parallel. Now, I assume you've seen the videos before this one, which explain the use of Lavan syntax to define a model and how to fit such a model in genomic SEM, and how to run a user-specified GWAS in genomic SEM. And if you are able to do those things, or if you take the time to watch those videos, then you should be able to follow the entirety of this lecture easily. We developed this model for use in a paper where we want to look at cognitive and non-cognitive contributions to educational attainment. I have to thank all the authors of the paper, obviously, but especially Perlina, my PhD student, and Margarita, who shared first authors, and then the other senior authors, Daniel Belsky and Paige Harden. Okay, now there's some key resources related to this work, right? So studying the genetics of education always makes sense to outline your motivations and why you're studying a specific topic. And since this is a technical lecture on how to use the model, I'm not going to go into it, but I do want to point you towards our FAQ and the motivation for doing the study. Technical tutorial, which you can actually have a really quick look at because I set it open this other screen. So a technical tutorial, which is available, which actually walks you through the code all the way from just downloading the raw GWAS data from the website of the SSGAC, the Social Science Genetics Association Consortium, processing some stats, fitting the model, and fitting a GWAS. In the tutorial, you do a GWAS of 1,000 SNPs, right? Just because we want to keep the runtime for such a tutorial under like a couple of hours. This tutorial will basically give you all the ingredients you need to run the model we are discussing today. And it's something you can actually do during the workshop, because part of the assignments during the practical assignments during the workshop will be to run a GWAS by subtraction and some of the follow-up models we're discussing today. Okay, now. Then there's also a GitHub repository for the paper, which contains all the code we used throughout the paper. And that's a really handy resource for all the subtle follow-up analyses we're going to discuss today. And then finally, a link to an open access version of the paper so that you can get it, read it, and try to understand the model better and see whether it's something you want to apply in your work to a pair of traits or a number of traits. Now, for this GWAS, we had a specific goal. We wanted to know what affects educational success. Obviously, there's cognitive skills, which many people believe to be a large driver of educational success, but there's other traits, right? Such as motivation, curiosity, social skills, etc. These collectively are sometimes referred to as non-cognitive skills. Wouldn't it be nice to have a GWAS of those non-cognitive skills? Because then you could do all the things you do with GWAS. You can do biology and non-cognitive skills. You can use the summary statistics from the GWAS to compute genetic correlations to other traits to figure out whether there are specific non-cognitive traits that are very important for education. And you could use the summary statistics to do things like Mendelian randomization to figure out some of the mechanisms behind the correlations between educational attainment and other behavioral traits. But what is the phenotype, right? So there's many, many things that are referred to as non-cognitive skills. And I personally believe there are many things that are very important to success in education. Are they individually as important as your cognitive abilities? Probably not, but they all stack up and add up, and providing someone with the resources to be a successful student. Other than obvious factors outside the individual, which society places people in and which may or may not improve or reduce their chances of completing education. So anyway, if you'd want to do a GWAS of non-cognitive skills, you'd have to pick one or a few and figure out whether they're related among each other and whether it makes sense to analyze them in a GWAS, and you'd need sample size, like big sample sizes. And turns out, a lot of these measures have low heritability and poor test-retest reliability. So those things may be related. Maybe the poor test-retest reliability suggests just the measurement is fairly bad, which would cause low heritability, right? And then there's considerable heterogeneity in the way they associate with education. Okay, so we don't have the power. So the solution in genomic SEM, the solution we came up with, is a GWAS by subtraction. It's basically taking two observed variables, so two GWAS summary statistic files for cognitive performance and educational attainment, as made available publicly by the SSGAC. These are the Educational Attainment 3 GWAS Summary Statistics, Lee et al. 2018, and they're publicly available. We can translate the model on the left to syntax for use in Genomic SEM. So basically, the syntax we need to tell Genomic SEM how to run this model. I'm going to walk through it step by step now and take you through all the considerations. Okay, so the model actually begins with defining a latent variable cog or cognitive, and it's a factor that is measured by both cognitive performance and educational attainment. And so it is the effects that are shared between educational attainment and cognitive performance, right? So it explains all the variance in cognitive performance, and it explains all the covariance between cognitive performance and educational attainment. It implicitly kind of states that cognitive performance is causal for educational attainment, but we'll get to that when we discuss assumptions made in the model. Okay. Now the second thing we define is a latent variable non-cog, which loads on educational attainment. So it's measured by educational attainment and educational attainment alone. So it's the effects unique to educational attainment after accounting for cognitive performance. And in our paper, we go deeper into the results of like just this decomposition, in which we find that about 55% of the genetic variability in educational attainment is actually non-cognitive in nature, so not related to cognitive performance, which means there's lots of things contributing to what we consider the heritability of educational attainment. We need to impose some constraints on the observed variables because we're saying the entirety of the variance and covariance is for these traits, EA and cognitive performance, is actually explained by cog and non-cog. There's no other source of variation, which is also an assumption, right? So the lines in red in the model syntax define the covariance between cognitive performance and EA to be zero, the covariance between cognitive performance and itself, so basically the variance, to be zero, the residual variance, and the residual variance for educational attainment to also be zero, right? So this is how we constrain it using Lafan syntax, which you know if you've seen the video on Lafan syntax. It's by using the zero and the star, we can actually constrain the covariance or variance parameters to zero. Okay. Then we actually constrain the latent variables to have a variance of one and the covariance between the latent variables to be zero. So we're saying cognitive and non-cognitive skills are uncorrelated. And this is a sort of a technicality, like are they truly uncorrelated? Well, maybe in reality they are not, but also this is how we define non-cognitive, right? We define it as that variation in educational attainment that's actually unrelated to cognitive performance. So that in that part of the sentence, that clause unrelated kind of assumes a zero correlation. But later, we can actually, when we're going to go into assumptions, go back and check whether it matters that we assume this, which is a good thing to do, right? Check all your assumptions. Then we actually regress the latent variables cog and non-cog on a SNP. And we repeat this for every SNP in the genome. And then we've done a latent GWAS of cognitive and non-cognitive contributions to educational attainment. And so we get two Manhattan plots. One for cognitive skills, which is almost identical to the cognitive performance GWAS, and then non-cognitive skills, which is the variation in educational attainment that's not attributable to cognitive performance. Seems like a successful GWAS to me. But we went and checked whether it worked by using external traits such as childhood IQ and math ability, which are separate GWASs from the GWASs we put into the model, and actually showed that cognitive skills correlate highly with math ability and with childhood IQ, whereas non-cognitive skills do not. And this is as we expect, because childhood IQ is actually a precursor to your success in education, right? Your IQ is measured in this case before you finalize your education. So we expect it to be a measure of cognitive ability because it wasn't an IQ test. Okay, math abilities, similarly, are people's self-assessed math abilities, not their attainment. Right? We actually do have a correlation with attainment. I don't have it here, and it's far more evenly distributed between cognitive and non-cognitive. And we repeat the same with polygenic score analyses of crystallized and fluid intelligence. In all cases, though, there is still a residual correlation between non-cognitive and these other measures of what we feel are cognitive measures. We go into why this may be the case in the paper. And I think one of the main cases is that like the GWAS we use for cognitive performance is based on a really short cognitive performance test. That's part of the UK Biobank assessment. And it really doesn't represent all of cognitive performance or IQ very well. It's just a very narrow test, which is understandable. They needed to test for 500,000 people, so they'd want some test that's sort of readily given to people in, let's say, 5 to 10 minutes, because there's other things they'd want to measure in UK Biobank. Now, if you go and apply this to your traits of interest, it makes sense to really consider whether you meet all the assumptions. Okay, and so we're assuming here cognitive performance actually causes educational attainment. Why are we assuming this? Well, we're assuming this because we made this latent variable cog, which explains all the variation in cognitive performance. So it's essentially identical to cognitive performance. And then we're saying, well, all the covariance between educational attainment and cognitive performance is due to cog causing educational attainment, right? Because the arrow goes from cog to educational attainment. It's really important to consider that if you run a SEM model, the arrows you draw, they have, you know, you're drawing what you think is the causal structure in the world, right? And I, for one, am fairly easily convinced that a cognitive performance contributes causally to your performance in school. And there's obviously debate about it, but we can test whether these assumptions are important enough or whether their violation doesn't really influence our results. So that's what we're going to do right now. So are we okay with assuming cog and non-cog are correlated, right? So maybe there is other factors that are influencing both cog and non-cog, and thereby both cognitive performance and educational attainment. They're basically confounders. Are there confounders? And so sources other than causality that relate cognitive performance to educational attainment, right? And so you have this fixed covariance of zero between cog and non-cog. We can't freely estimate it because we don't have the degrees of freedom, right? See, we already use all the information that's available to us. So there's no way to freely estimate the parameter. What we can do is actually set it to some other value, 0.3, right? And check how that influences our results. So what we did, we actually set it to 0, 0.1, 0.2, or 0.3, and checked whether the correlations we observe in our paper and which we interpret between cog and external traits and between non-cog and external traits actually change meaningfully. So what you see now is sort of a GIF of the genetic correlation between non-cog in orange, cog in blue, and a whole bunch of traits. Now, both are highly correlated to household income, but if we change the covariance between non and non-cog, cog and non-cog, then actually there starts to be a difference between the correlation these both have to household income. And so the same happens for other traits, which you can see here, and we argue in the paper that the differences are there, but they're not necessarily of the magnitude where you'd think like, okay, that would sort of dramatically mess up our conclusions. So let's move on to a different assumption we can test. How can we deal with evidence that exists that actually educating people, so providing them with more education, improves their cognitive performance? So basically, there is a causal path from educational attainment to cognitive performance, and there is good reviews or meta-analyses of natural experiments that sort of definitively shows, or very convincingly shows, that if people are educated more, right? Not by choice, but because they're, born in a certain month and therefore can go to school younger, or they were born right after the government changed the school leaving age from 16 to 18 years old, which gives them 2 more years of education outside their control, right? If you contrast those people to people born a year earlier who could leave at 16, then on average, those groups will differ in their education. And you can observe that those groups, while they're otherwise the same, right, differ in terms of their IQ. And there's all kinds of natural experiments or designs with controls you can perform. And Stuart Ritchie and Elliot Tucker-Drop did so, and they show that actually for every year of education, you seem to gain about between 1 and 5 IQ points, right? So there is definitely not only a causal effect from cognitive performance on educational attainment, there's also a reverse causal effect, which is pretty strong, right? If we're looking at the high end here, like 5 IQ points, that would be 0.3 standard deviation per year of education. That's a pretty big effect. For us, in this model, that actually means we may want to account for an effect of educational cognitive performance, right? So the red arrow I just added to the model, we can actually fix that by amending the model code with a regression of cognitive performance on educational attainment. And we cannot estimate it because we don't have the degrees of freedom, but we can fix it at some value. Now here we fixed it at a value that is approximately consistent with the effect observed in the meta-analysis I just showed you, right? And then what we did in our paper, we actually reran all the analysis, correlational analysis, and some of the GWAS analysis for the hits, and actually showed that look, most, even with a reverse causal effect consistent with prior literature in place, we actually find similar results for the correlation between COG and non-COG and external traits, and we find very similar results for the top hits. So this effect certainly exists, that educational attainment influences cognitive performance. The findings we have with respect to non-cognitive skills, which are like the main trait of interest in this paper, right? The new trait we can actually extract using GWAS by subtraction, those conclusions all hold. And that's great. Genomic SEM is very flexible, right? Now, it doesn't work point and click. You can specify a model, and there's other ways to do this kind of analysis in genomic data, right? I've written a paper on it, on a technique called GWIS, and there's techniques developed by the group in Australia that could actually split signal from two traits into two parts. One is that shared and one that's unique to one of the traits. But what genomic SEM offers you beyond the basic ability to split signal into traits is actually the ability to take into account prior evidence in your model, consider alternative models with correlations between your latent traits or reverse causal effects being in place. Basically, check all the assumptions and then rerun the model and rerun your analysis and figure out whether the violation of the assumptions you think are important actually matter for your results. And so that's a flexibility that comes with this. Flexibility comes at a cost. It always does. In this case, it comes at a cost that you need to understand the models better to be able to implement model violations, right? You need to understand where to add this regression from cognitive performance on educational attainment in the model. And I hope this tutorial will help you do so. And it also means you need to think very hard about what your model implies in terms of causality, right? So people come up to me, and I've considered it myself, splitting the signal between bipolar disorder and schizophrenia. It'd be really cool to identify genetic effects that contribute to schizophrenia but do not contribute to bipolar disorder. Genetic effects that contribute to bipolar disorder but do not contribute to schizophrenia. But what's giving me pause is that I find it really hard to specify a causal model there. Like, there is no causality in my mind from observed schizophrenia on bipolar disorder, right? They have a shared common set of genetic influences, but that's not exactly the same as specifying a causal relationship in one direction or the other. So anyway, that's just me rambling about possible applications for this model, but I want to encourage you before you apply is to really think through the causal model you're defining and really think through ways the model may be wrong, and then testing if you allow the model to accommodate those things where you think the model may be wrong, whether your conclusions change. Okay, that's it for me right now. Thank you for listening and see you in the next video.